In this video, we talk about a special type of linear regression where the independent variable x is a categorical variable. Our previous videos on linear regression include independent variables that are only numerical. The topics of this video include the following: categorical x with two values, or with more than two values, and forecasting using regression. Let's first take a look at independent variables that are categorical. For categorical variables that take two values only, we call them binary variables. For example, some binary variables include gender at birth. We could use 1 to represent female and 0 to represent male. Another example is whether the driving assignment involves the highway or not. The convention is to use 1 to represent yes and 0 to represent no. It is very important to notice that as long as a variable has two categories, for example, A and B, we can always use a binary variable to represent it. We can change A and B to A and not A, and then 1 to 0. For categorical variables that take more than two values, we can divide them into two groups, ordinal versus no order. For the ordinal group, one example is the subject's education level. The education level could include no diploma, diploma, associate, or college. As you can see, there is an actual order to the values. For the no order group, one example is cities. The values include Portland, Seattle, Los Angeles, New York City, Boston, and Miami. There is no natural ordering in the cities. You could certainly sort the cities by their first letters, but there are other ways to do that. We don't have a preference for doing one way over the other. Let's focus on the binary independent variables first. That's the categorical x with two values. This is the same tracking example that we analyzed earlier. I'm going to use the time as my response variable or dependent variable. Other than miles and deliveries, I will also consider highway as my independent variable. The highway variable is a binary variable as it only takes values 1 or 0. 1 represents the driving assignment involves a highway, while 0 represents the driving assignment does not include highway. The highway variable we just saw can also be called a dummy variable or indicator variable. This type of variable only takes two values, 1 if it is true and 0 if it is false. Sometimes we may need to transform our variable into 1s and zeros. For our tracking data, we do not need to create a column for the dummy variable because the values are already in 1 and 0 for highway. Using XLSTAT, we can run a linear regression model using these three different independent variables: miles, deliveries, and highway. One thing I like to point out is that highway is a categorical variable, but because the values are coded as 1 and 0, highway should be treated as a quantitative variable, not a qualitative variable in XLSTAT. For a recap of how we can use XLSTAT for simple linear regression, please click on the video linked on the upper right corner of this screen. The XLSTAT output is given on this screen, and there are three sets of different tables. All the p-values indicate that all three independent variables are important to predict time. Let's take a closer look at our binary variable highway. The slope estimate for highway is 0.998, which indicates that if one assignment involves a highway, it will take about 1 hour more than another assignment with the same distance driven and the same number of deliveries. The R-square is much higher than the threshold of 70%. The F-test also suggests that this is a sufficiently useful model. Next, let's move on to categorical independent variables with more than two values. This time, we consider a delivery time variable. Delivery time holds four different values: morning, afternoon, evening, and night. Some software may require us to manually convert delivery time into several dummy variables. We don't need to do that in XLSTAT. One question for you to think about is, how can we use dummy variables to represent the delivery time? And how many dummy variables do we need to use? For categorical variables with four values like delivery time, we just need three dummy variables. For example, if we pick night as the reference or baseline level, we will create three dummy variables: delivery time morning, delivery time afternoon, and delivery time evening. Delivery time morning is 1 for morning deliveries and 0 otherwise. Delivery time afternoon is 1 for afternoon deliveries. And delivery time evening is 1 for evening deliveries. Each assignment will have 3 numbers from these 3 dummy variables. For morning delivery assignment, it will be coded as 100. And for an evening delivery assignment, it will be coded as 001. And for a night delivery assignment, it will be coded as 00. For linear regression in XLSTAT, this time, we have to input delivery time as a qualitative or categorical variable here. This is the coefficient table obtained from XLSTAT. Night is used as the reference level. So you can see the slope coefficient for night is actually 0. All other 3 levels, afternoon, evening, and morning, they are all compared to the reference night level. In XLSTAT, the level that starts with the last alphabet is automatically used as the reference level, because night begins with the letter N, while other levels start with A, E, and M. So night is used as a reference for our dataset. If you like to use morning as your reference level, all you need to do is replace all morning in your Excel dataset with a small letter Z morning, and this will be used as the reference level automatically. We can write out the estimated equation model using estimated time equals to 2.324 plus 0.069 multiplied by miles plus 0.260 multiplied by evening indicator variable plus 0.018 multiplied by afternoon indicator variable, plus 0.160 multiplied by morning indicator variable. Let's consider the following question. What's the estimated time when the distance is 80 miles and the delivery time is in the morning? All we need to do is plug 80 miles into the formula and the delivery time into the morning delivery. And all other 2 dummy variables or indicator variables, you leave them as 0. We calculate the estimated time is about 8 hours. Consider a similar question where the distance is 75 miles and the delivery time is at night. This time, we plug miles equals to 75 and set all 3 dummy variables to 0. This is because for night deliveries, the values of these 3 dummy variables are all 0, 0, and 0. We calculate the estimated time to be about 7 hours and 30 minutes. We try to interpret the slope coefficients, especially those for the dummy variables. The slope coefficient for evening deliveries is 0.26. 0.26 is the difference in time between evening deliveries and the reference night deliveries. That means holding all other variables the same, an assignment that was delivered in the evening is going to take 0.26 hours more than another assignment that was delivered at night. We can also see that, on average, afternoon deliveries takes 0.018 hours. That's about 1 minute more than night deliveries. We can rank delivery time from the slowest to the fastest. The evening deliveries takes the longest time, followed by morning deliveries, afternoon deliveries, the fastest deliveries are at night. One thing to point out is that all p-values of those 3 dummy variables are at least 25%, very high. This suggests that the delivery time variables are not significantly. This suggests that the delivery time variables are not a statistically significant predictor of time. Therefore, we should remove them from our final model. I would recommend refitting the data using only miles and testing out other independent variables in the dataset. For the remaining of the video, we will discuss how we can use linear regression for forecasting. We can use regression to forecast in time if the following conditions are satisfied. First, the observations are measured at regularly spaced time points. The data could be daily data, weekly, monthly, quarterly, or annual observations. We should be able to check the data has a time feature in it. Next, we also need a response variable to be linearly related to this time variable. This can be done by plotting or eyeballing. Let's take a look at this example. We have quarterly sales data, the number of copies sold for a college textbook over the past 3 years. We have also plotted these 12 data points using a time series plot. The vertical axis is the number of copies sold, and the horizontal axis is the time measured in quarters. Our goal is to predict the sales in year 4. There are usually 4 steps when we try to forecast using regression. Because the data may not necessarily be in a format that we can use right away, the first step is to sort all observations in time and convert data into a proper format. Second, we need to create a time index variable starting from 1 to the last row of this newly formatted data. We then run a linear regression model using y against the time index variable we just created and any other time variables that we may want to use in the dataset. You could also include other explanatory variables in the dataset. In the very last step, to forecast the y, we can either plug a future time value for the time variable into the model or use the software for forecasting directly. I'm going to show you how we can do these 4 steps for our textbook example. In step 1, we convert data into a proper format and make sure that each row represents one set of observations. We cannot use the raw data format given earlier. We have to create 3 columns to represent a year, quarter, and the sales. Each row represents one of the 12 data points we have seen earlier. And also make sure that the sales data is sorted in time. In step 2, we create a time index variable starting from 1. This variable is saved in column B. The first quarter in year 1 has a time index of 1, and the second quarter in year 1 has a time index 2. The last quarter in year 3 has a time index of 12. It is very essential to have this step when you try to forecast using linear regression. After creating the time index variable, we now can run a linear regression model using y, that's the sales, against the time index variable we just created and other time variables in this dataset. Because the data is quarterly data, I'm going to use quarter variable in column C in my regression. We now use XLSTAT to run our linear regression. For the explanatory variables, the quarter variable in column C should be selected as a qualitative or categorical variable. On the other hand, the time index variable we just created in column B should be selected as a quantitative or numerical variable. The coefficient table shows that there is a clearly quarterly effect on textbook sales as all p-values are very small. The time index variable is also very significant. Both the F-test in the ANOVA table and R-squared in the goodness of fit table also suggest that this model is highly useful. Using the estimated slope coefficients, we can write down the predicted sales using time index and a quarter. Q4 is used as the reference data. Compared to Q4 sales, Q3 sales are about 350 copies small, Q2 sales are about 1,465 copies less, and Q1 sales are about 642 copies less. If you rank the quarterly sales, the third quarter has the higher sales, followed by the fourth quarter, the first quarter, and the second quarter. These results are not surprising because the largest enrollments in universities are usually during the fall term, which is in the third quarter, and textbook sales may go up a lot during that time. Let's see how we can use our model to predict the sales in year 4. There are 4 quarters in year 4 to predict. Before we plug all the numbers into the estimated equation, it is very important to notice that both time indexed and also the dummy variables will change. For example, for quarter 1 in year 4, the time index is 13, and the time index for last quarter in year 4 is 16. After we plug all these numbers and also the quarter information into our predicted equation model, we are able to predict the sales for year 4. In fact, these calculations can be done automatically in XLSTAT. We first enter the future observations we would like to predict in our spreadsheet. For our example, that includes the values for the time index variable for year 4 and also the values for the quarter variable. Under the prediction tab for linear regression, we need to manually select these variable values for prediction as we have done here. As you can see on the screen, the XLSTAT predictions are identical to those outputs we calculated using manual plugins. But one advantage of using XLSTAT is besides the point predictions, XLSTAT also give us confidence interval predictions. In our videos, we have talked about several commonly used statistical tools, including graphs and summary statistics, confidence interval estimation and hypothesis testing, and also most recently linear regression. All of these methods have their own advantages and disadvantages. For example, in linear regression, we can usually include more variables or factors in our analysis, so it is very flexible. If we think delivery time is important for the total time taken for each assignment, we can include delivery time in our model. However, linear regression is a little bit more time-consuming than hypothesis testing, as it involves choosing the best model, assessing the model for the goodness of fit, and checking model assumptions. In any case, I hope you have found these tools useful in analyzing different kinds of data for a wide range of applications. This also ends this video. Thank you very much for watching. I will see you in the next video.